morning, everybody. Welcome to the University of Miami. We're in Florida. This for the 78th Annual American Humanist Association Conference. I'm Jennifer Barty. I'm the Deputy Director of the American Humanist Association and the Editor-in-Chief of the Humanist Magazine. Our first speaker is Bertha Vazquez. She's an award-winning science teacher with 28 years as an educator. She's the director of the Center for Inquiry's Teacher Institute for Evolutionary Science. And today she's going to speak to us about promoting evolution education in the United States. Thank you, Bertha.
Thank you for joining us. This is so nice for me because I travel around the country to do this presentation, and I traveled 5 minutes this morning, and that's a wonderful thing. So thank you for you coming. As she just mentioned, I am the director of the Teacher Institute for Evolutionary Science. But first and foremost, I'm a science teacher. I've been teaching here locally now for 28 years. I just finished school on Friday, so I feel very happy and refreshed. And when people ask me, you know, what does it feel like to be a science teacher? You know what? It's the greatest job on earth. I feel sometimes like I have a cape. You know, I come out of the phone booth and I have a cape, because what you're doing is you're unlocking the wonders of the universe for children. And it's not just teaching them a body of knowledge, which is a very wonderful, interesting body of knowledge, also teaching them a way of thinking, that I'm pretty sure everyone in this room espouses. And then there's evolution education. So you would think that I don't really have to deal with this pseudo-controversy. I'm in the best middle school, in public middle school in Florida. I think the biggest issue I have is students are often confused what they're allowed to believe. It's not that, you know, here in a big urban area like Miami, I don't really deal with some of the creationist issues that some of my fellow teachers deal with in other parts of the country. But kids are confused because it is... We've allowed the creationists to kind of taint the conversation. Some students I've had are downright defiant about learning evolution. I had a young man about 3 years ago just turn his chair to the wall during the unit. I'm talking like, you know, 2 weeks, and he's just turned his chair to the wall. And some are just anxious in both directions. They don't understand why there are people who don't accept evolution in the classroom and why they're producing this tension. This isn't easy for teachers, because our job is to make children feel comfortable in a classroom. So this tension is not something that we like. And I say, why? Why is this an issue? I mean, look at these quotes from the AAAS. The contemporary theory of biological evolution is one of the most robust products of scientific inquiry. Evolution is thoroughly tested and confirmed, strong and well supported. So why do we have this issue in this country? What's going on? And I think the best definition or conclusion of what's going on was presented by the National Science Teachers Association. It's a century of political controversy that has prevented evolution from being emphasized in science curricula. So let's take a brief look at that century so you guys understand what I'm talking about. First of all, there's Epperson v. Arkansas in 1968. Evolution was banned in this country. In the classroom. Teaching evolution was banned until 1968. You know, the famous John Scopes trial, we lost that trial. So it was 1968 that we finally were able to teach evolution. In 1975, another court case said, balancing evolution with creationism is unconstitutional. So now we can no longer teach creationism. 1975, can no longer teach creationism. But all they did was change the name creationism to creation science. And so now that led up into 1987. So they just basically put creationism and put a tuxedo on it, kind of thing. And then what came after creation science? Do you all know the next term? See, you guys, straight A's for you. Kitzmiller v. Dover, 2005, is a Pennsylvania case, where now balancing intelligent design with evolution is unconstitutional. So as you can see, basically what they've done is just change the name. So that's it, we won, 2005, right? We don't have to deal with this anymore. That's it. You can't teach creationism, you can't teach creation science, you can't teach intelligent design, whatever you want to call it, it's unconstitutional. Well, this is where we are today, and it's so pervasive. It's called academic freedom. And doesn't that sound lovely? I mean, We should allow teachers to promote academic freedom. We should allow children to debate. We should look at the evidence for and against. These are all words that we love. I love these words as a science teacher, but really it's just smoke and mirrors for sneaking in creationism. Since it didn't work in the justice system, in the judicial system, they're trying to sneak it in as an academic freedom thing. It's kind of like allowing kids to decide between chemistry and alchemy, or astrology and astronomy. So this is where science teachers are. This issue and climate change, those are the two that we have a real tough time teaching. So what is the result? This is the result. Even though it's been 1968, it's unconstitutional to teach creationism in class, we have 62% pretty much of Americans who favor teaching creationism along with evolution in our public schools. So they've done a very good job of promoting creationism. This is very small. I know it's hard for you to see, but I have a great big green arrow for you. This was a question asked in different countries. Humans evolved, true or false? Very simple question. Can you find the United States? Let me help you. Boom. Second to the last, next to Turkey. Down there. We beat Turkey, yay. So, yeah. So how does this affect our teachers? The numbers I just gave you are general population. How does this affect the teachers in the classroom? Well, when they ask if they feel pressured to teach creationism, 31% of high school biology teachers said that they did feel pressured. 31% of high school biology teachers. Now, I'm a middle school science teacher, which is even worse. Where was that pressure coming from, they were asked? Well, mainly students and parents. Only 3% is coming from administration. Did they feel pressure to omit or simply de-emphasize evolution? Yes, indeed, 30% agreed that they did. And this is the one that kills me, and it's been done in different studies, and the numbers always add up to about 13 to 16% of high school biology teachers openly espouse the idea that the Earth was created 6,000 years ago. Yeah, you thought it was higher? Oh, was it? Well, we have to go back to our 17th century bishop, James Usher, is that correct? He's the one that calculated the age of the earth based on the begets in the Bible. So, to make matters worse, it's not just the parents and the students that push this sometimes. Let me explain to you really quickly what that is what you call a curriculum guide for teachers. This is coming from Troup County, Georgia. Teachers receive this from their county, from their curriculum specialists, and this explains to them how to open the unit on evolution. This is how they're supposed to do it. I know you can't read it, it's awfully small, but I wanted you to see that it's actually there. I'm not making this up. It'd be something like this. Hi, little student Johnny. Little student Johnny, would you explain to little student Annie what a zombie is? Little Annie, will you explain to Johnny what a vampire is? Go ahead, you give them 5-10 minutes, and then you say, okay, now Annie, now you understand what a zombie is. You don't believe in zombies, but you understand what they are. Okay, children, now we're gonna teach evolution. You don't have to believe in evolution, but you have to understand what it is. So a lot of teachers will talk about it as, well, you have to take a test at the end of the year, so I'm just gonna teach this because you have to understand what it is. Just repeating that makes me nervous. The other thing is that when you go to the NEA, the National Educators Association National Conference, this is probably the most important educational organization in the country. Ken Ham and Company, as of Noah's Ark over in Kentucky, they have a booth. And that really legitimizes them to have a booth in the most important education conference in the country. Now, there's a loophole. They're in there because of a loophole, and they're trying to close that loophole. But as of this year, they were still there. And they give a bunch of stuff away, nice, glossy books and CDs and things to the teachers. So what's a teacher to do? I mean, what is the result of all of this? The result of all of this is that you have that green end of the spectrum there, teachers who are doing a great job. Sound teaching, teaching evolution the way it should be done, as the underlying theme of the biological sciences. You have the people on the end, that 13 to 16% that are promoting creationism in the classroom, and then you have this cautious middle. This cautious middle accept evolution, but they may not understand it as well, or they might be scared of the repercussions in the class. I mean, I have teachers who have reached out to me where their entire class of kids, this is in North Carolina, put Bibles on the desks when they were about to teach evolution. I have another friend in Georgia who started a hiking club. How fun is that, a hiking club? And just offhand, without thinking about it, she picked up a rock, much like the rocks we have here in Florida that you could tell there were shells, you know, because we were underwater 150,000 years ago. And she explained to the kids, oh, look, it's a shell, and because Georgia was underwater, I guess they have similar geology, I'm not sure about the geology of Georgia, but they canceled her hiking club. In another case, a teacher was going to teach evolution, and the Spanish teacher across the hall said, can I have a list of your students so I can pray for them? This is the type of stuff, and you know, teachers, we don't like controversy. I run from controversy. I try to fix things with children and parents. I don't like to be in the middle of confrontation. It's one of the reasons I think I picked this profession. So it's not easy for this cautious middle. So why is this all important? I think it's important because we need science to innovate. We need science to be the foundation of the future of our economy and our society. At least I feel that way. Science has given us so much as a nation. Cited in this study, we know that science is the way to move forward. And I think a better education is a solution to this problem that we have. I mean, we put a man on the moon, right? It's one of the science in this country is one of the things I'm most proud of. Science education and evolution education is essential to understand the biological sciences. It's the underlying theme. A famous scientist said that teaching biology without evolution is just stamp collecting. It's not putting together the ideas. So there's hope, as you can see on my t-shirt and as you can see on the slide. The Teacher Institute for Evolutionary Science. And I don't like to leave a group depressed, so I am going to give you some more optimistic numbers. While there's a 60% level of evolution acceptance among US adults, that number does go up to 68% between younger people 18 to 29 years of age. Why? I want to say that it has to do with better evolution education. And I want to say it has to do with also with great models like Bill Nye and Neil deGrasse Tyson and Carl Sagan and Sid the Science Guy when they're little and stuff. So this group is coming up more science savvy and more accepting of evolution education. And I haven't seen a problem in my own classroom in a few years now, to be honest. But that's anecdotal, I know. So look, I love this quote, that if all teachers just took a course in evolutionary biology, there'd be a substantial impact on the emphasis of evolution. We have to teach a lot of different things. So you can't be an expert in everything. So if we can give them a better focus, better content on evolution education, I think it would really, really improve the situation. I think, as Dr. Caitlin Shrine believes, a good teacher can teach anything as long as you give him or her the content and the resources to do so. So enter the Teacher Institute for Evolutionary Science, and that's why I'm here. So how did ties begin? Completely serendipitously, I met Richard Dawkins a few times, actually here at the University of Miami. Thank you, University of Miami. And I told him that I had done professional development, quick little workshops for my fellow middle school science teachers on evolution. And he said, wow, I really like that idea. I thought he was just being nice, because he is actually a very nice guy. Well, no, he called me the next day. And he said, I want to help you. How can I help you? Picture that. You know, I'm getting a phone call in the middle of my class from Richard Dawkins. And I happen to be a lifelong reader of his books and fan of his. And I said, well, you know, Dr. Dawkins, you do help me. I mean, I use your books and I use your videos and you have really good stuff. And he said, no, I mean, can I come and speak to these teachers? Okay, after I picked myself off the floor, he came to my middle school right here in Coconut Grove 2 weeks later and met with those teachers. Miami-Dade County opened it up to all the high school science teachers in the county. And I think that's awesome. And I also had some students there. So we had hundreds of people there and we just talked evolution. And then he said, will you do this for me nationally? I said, oh gosh, I'm just a middle school science teacher. I don't know if I could do this. He goes, yes, I think you can do this. With the accent, of course. But I think you can do this. And I tried. So I sat down, I said, what should this group, this organization, this project, what should it provide? First and foremost, we need to provide content, because a lot of science teachers, particularly at the middle school level, may not know the content. I, for example, have to teach geology sometimes. I don't know, or when I first taught weather systems, I didn't know the difference between an occluded front and a stationary front. I'm a biology major. So teachers need help on content. It's just natural, at least at the beginning. A lot of online resources, free online resources. Our website is full of them. Oh gosh, the word theory and other misconceptions. The word theory is used casually all the time. I have a theory that the Miami Dolphins are going to win the Super Bowl next year. Not a good theory, I know. I think it's okay to use it that way, but that's not what it means in science. And when we throw the word around casually and people think it's just a theory, and you say that like it's a bad thing, it's not a bad thing. So we really explain to teachers what theory means. Science inquiry. I think that is the root of all of this. And as a member of the staff of her Center for Inquiry and the Richard Dawkins Foundation for Reason and Science, this is a direction I'd like to take the project. More about understanding how to look at what's in front of you, analyze the data, and come up with the conclusions. Like, good conclusions, not, you know, homeopathy worked because my cat was sick and it got better because I gave it homeopathy. I really focus on the current relevance of evolution. I think, of course, Darwin's pivotal and important and everything else. But when you talk to children about antibiotic resistance and pesticide resistance and conservation, biology and how they pick the best places in the world to conserve because of the biodiversity there. We need to promote this. My favorite moment in a TIES workshop, a teacher came in and said, yeah, I don't really believe any of this. I just teach it because I have to. And I did my spiel in the morning with the content and everything. And I always invite a guest scientist to join me. And this guest scientist, he worked with chickpeas. And chickpeas are dying. The chickpea crop in the world is suffering due to climate change, and it provides 30% of the world's population with its primary source of protein. So he goes to Iraq and southern Turkey and takes wild chickpea that literally grows out of trees, rocks and stuff, hybridizes them with the crop strain of the chickpea, and is helping the chickpea crop survive. That's important. And at the end, this same teacher who said, yeah, I don't believe any of this stuff, she goes, oh, I get it now. I get this. This is important. And I'm not going to teach it the same way again. That was my favorite TIES moment. There's lots of my favorite TIES, but that was my favorite. Another thing we promote is I purposely put Richard Dawkins and Kenneth Miller in this slide. The content of the slide is not relevant, but I tell teachers, it's relevant to the content, but not for what I'm trying to say right now. You know, if you had one of these two guys teach your unit, come into your classroom and teach evolution for you, first of all, you'd be lucky. Secondly, there should be no difference in the content delivered. In other words, the fact that one of them is an atheist and the other one is a devout Catholic should not make a difference in the content delivered. Evolution is evolution. It is what it is. And if you don't know who Kenneth Miller is, he's the greatest defender of evolution education in our country. He's a professor at Brown University and the author of my textbook and a lot of biology textbooks around the country. Terrific guy. We also provide support for teachers. For example, I get emails like this one here on the left-hand side of the screen, and I help teachers respond to these emails. I make sure their responses are short and sweet. Basically, it's not up to me, it's up to the state curriculum, and I'm not discussing it any further. That's what that slide says. I also tell them, hey, you're not alone. Look at all these organizations. Look at the position of the National Science Teachers Association and the position of National Association of Biology Teachers, et cetera. You are well supported. You're not alone. I want you to meet some of our TIES members. They're from all over the country. There's 66 members at this point. I don't travel all over the country to do this. I recruit teachers and train them, mainly high school biology teachers who can then present to middle school science teachers. But as you can see, we're a fun group. I wanted to show you some pictures of what the workshops look. I make sure they're trying out in the workshops everything that they're going to be taking back to their classrooms with them for free. So you can see some teachers all over the country there. That was our largest one ever, 75 people in Texas. That was a big one. That was in Georgia, Montana, Alabama, Virginia, with the First Lady of Virginia, who was a former biology teacher on your right. So teachers, what are they saying about our workshops? We love the websites. We love the idea of going to a PD on science content, professional development. We love the labs. Thank you. Thank you for making TIDES the most useful evolutionary education group in the country. Best workshop I have ever attended. So I feel really proud of this kind of stuff that we get back on our evaluations. So here you have some students now that I get pictures back from the teachers. So as you can see, they're kind of doing the same stuff the teachers were doing. And I think that's pretty neat. And I wanted to show you, this is my favorite slide. Started in 2015 with 10 workshops. 2017 was a banner year. 2018, and right now we have 25 workshops so far and counting. We are at 156, probably more than that. I didn't add that up right. 66 different presenters in 48 US states. There's our map of where we've presented. So it's really gone viral, literally. We look for partnerships, so we do monthly webinars with different scientists. These are some of the scientists that have done monthly webinars, which we open up to everybody, and they're free. So we try to connect scientists with their teachers and their students. I've formed a wonderful partnership with the largest secular homeschooling association in the country. And I thought that was important to do. We've been in the news quite a bit, and hopefully we're going to be on HBO Vice next October. And we were the main article in the Scientific American magazine last August. So thank you. And I think I got in there. I got it in there.